Hello, I'm BJ Williams. Welcome to KTLA Voices Presenting Mental State, where we explore the state of mental health and the challenges facing various communities across the nation. With July being Minority Mental Health Awareness Month, we brought together four men to talk about vulnerability with our partnership with Can I Be Vulnerable? So, fellas.
What's going on, man? How you doing, man?
Yeah, I don't want to talk.
Good. What's up, bro?
Yeah, listen, why don't you introduce yourselves,
Corey? Yeah. All right, I'm Hershel Dennis. Former USC tailback from 02 to 07, the creator of Healing Depression. I partner up with We Are Working Together and also athleticcounselor.org. And it's just organizations that provide platforms and resources for younger athletes to have the proper mentorship that they need to help them through their athletic journey. So,
right, man.
Aaron Mancell, just from Rancho Cucamonga, California. Just Can I Be Vulnerable? Alumni. I don't have all the extent.
That's it.
What's up? My name is Thomas Williams. I'm a former NFL football player turned author, motivational speaker. First book, Permission to Dream, for middle school and high school kids, and The Relentless Pursuit of Greatness, helping athletes transition into the next stage and the next play of their life.
And man. Finally.
What's up, people? My name is Jimmy V. I'm an actor. I'm as well as a host. I'm the creator of Building My Empire, which is all about sharing information and knowledge so we can all build our empires together, you know. So BMEofficial.com.
Sounds good. All right, so these are the alumni. We're going to jump right to it, man. We got a little delayed a little bit, so we're going to jump right to it. Yeah. So first of all, I'm sorry, Can I Be Vulnerable is a docuseries that I created with my own personal story. And kind of just grew from there. So I was able to ask a bunch of friends of mine if they would be willing to be vulnerable with me on camera, telling their personal stories, their trials, their tribulations, their growth, their, you know, their wins. So we're going to talk about that with a few questions. So Hershel, we're going to start with you, man. In your video, one of your themes was you talked about incarceration.
Mm-hmm.
You know, take us through that little portion of your video of your episode and tell us how that was for you.
Well. The incarceration part, I think it was a mind-opening experience for me.
Mm-hmm.
It really woke me up to my capabilities of what I actually am capable of doing.
Right.
Before that happened, you know, my mindset wasn't quite where it needed to be in terms of knowing exactly who I am. And it took a dramatic misfortune situation for me to recognize, you
right.
know, who I am and what I'm capable of. And the whole idea that why I started the organization and why we're working with Can I Be Vulnerable and everybody else mm-hmm. is to help these young athletes kind of not allow themselves to get to that place.
Right.
And basically kind of figure out who they are outside of the sport. So they could, you know, when that transition does happen to them, and it will happen, it just be a little bit more smoother. So when that happened to me, man, I think I was about 31, and it took me to 31, you know.
To figure it out.
Yeah, to figure it out. And once I did, then, you know, a whole nother energy and motivation,
right.
you know, comes about. So we could get that motivation into the kids a little bit earlier, man. It's very beneficial.
Mid-30s, I'm still trying to figure that out.
Yeah. Tell me about it.
Where I'm going to.
Yeah. Right.
Aaron, for you, you talked about, you know, one of the strong themes in yours was accountability.
Yeah.
And you had this quote that I say this now is, I didn't have a hard life, I made my life hard.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And that stuck out with me. But this is your story, man. Tell us a little bit about why accountability was such a strong thing for you.
If you met my mom, you know she's the type of person who, she tells you what it is, you got to hold yourself accountable. She's not going to sit there and hold your hand. You know right from wrong.
Right.
You know what you got to do, so just do it. Anytime I mess up, it's on me. School, she wasn't one of those people who, well, the parents aren't helping, they're not doing nothing. No, you're in class, I'm not.
Right.
So it was always just, that's just how she was in
right.
everything I did. I was not much, I wasn't very accountable, and it was something I had to work on myself. Now it's something I hold my daughter to, I hold friends to, I hold family to. Mm-hmm. And as I get older, I want people to be more accountable emotionally, because I had people who would put their emotions on me and make me responsible for it.
Mm-hmm.
I said, now this year I can't be accountable for people who aren't emotionally evolved. They gotta work on their own emotions.
You know what? That's funny you say that, man. Because I just had a small thing earlier this morning about, like, if you don't tell me how you feel, I can't.
I'm not going to know.
I can't do anything about it. Right. I'm not going to sit here and guess or try to pull it out of you. You'll tell me when you're ready.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, so that being emotionally responsible with somebody's like, man, I'll help.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to do the work for you.
And people love to throw it on you about how they feel instead of trying to step back and say, well, how did I get here to these feelings? Right. Why is it their fault that I'm feeling this way? Because you have a choice. You have a choice with your emotions. You have a choice with your life. You don't have to be emotional and let it control you. You got to learn to control it.
Right. And you talked about accountability in yours, too.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. It's huge, man.
And doing that. So, Thomas, yours, you talked about an insecurity.
Yeah.
You know, growing up biracial, you're not black enough, you're not right. white enough.
Right.
You know, and that how that carried you throughout, how you maneuvered through, you know, through life.
Yeah.
I mean, so I'm going to let you.
Yeah, you know, and I wasn't able to identify it until I got done playing football. Right. So talking about the transition, being done with ball, because the whole entire time I was growing up, I used those insecurities and masked them, literally, and, you know, with the face mask and helmet. And then once I took the jersey off, once I took the helmet off, those insecurities faced me face to face. And they said, what you gonna do? You gonna run?
Right.
Where you gonna run to?
Right.
And you don't have anywhere to run when it's just you in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And so growing up, being biracial, you know, black and white, not knowing where to fit in. You know, when I'm with this side of the family, this is how we do things. When I'm with this side of the family, this is how we do another. And I think it was the hardest thing of just like Aaron was talking about, is that I didn't hold myself accountable and saying, this is what I want to do with my life. Right. I can't blame mom, I can't blame dad, I can't blame this is the way that God created me. And so for me, the hardest part of insecurities is that you have to look in the mirror and say, this is what I'm insecure about.
Yeah.
Because so many of us, I've had people, you know, in conversations will say, you're insecure. And insecure is not a correct term. I have insecurities,
right.
but I'm not insecure. But some of the different issues, whether it was biracial, being afraid to speak up in classrooms, not wanting to read out loud when I was growing up because I didn't want the stigma of a dumb jock. So the insecurities, man, take me a long time. And to be honest with you, the only way I was able to get through it was through going to see a therapist.
Right.
Wow. And so that's one of the biggest things that helped me with those insecurities.
That's funny. We're going to transition right to Jimmy V over here, because you talked about in your video having a speech impediment. And I remember you said not wanting to talk to anybody, let alone read out loud in school. And now you're an actor and a host.
Right. That's
so
right.
So talk about the triumph. Well, the tribulation and the triumph of having a speech impediment and coming to you now.
Ever since a kid, you know, just struggling to get what you actually want to say out. You just always have a constant thought inside your head. I know exactly what I want to say, but actually speaking it, you know, it's always tough, but it's always how those you're speaking to, you see it in their eyes as if, you know, they feel bad or, you know, many different things of that sort. So just as I got older and comfortable with myself, I just always said, I've got a story to share, you know, which is why now I understand why I love to act, because I tell other stories through different characters. So just to go back to myself, I just always keep in mind that there's also somebody else out there that stutters as well, and they don't speak up because I know exactly how that feeling was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's tough, you know? But once you understand that your voice is where you get your strength from, you Gucci.
Right.
All right.
We're gonna go back down the line again. With Can I Be Vulnerable, what, if I can ask, what was the hardest part to you about, you know, the interviews we did?
I think just basically facing your insecurities, like Thomas was saying, being able to recognize them, and because if you don't recognize them, or if you're not comfortable with sharing them, you know, how can anybody going to help you?
Right.
You know, and I think that was the biggest thing with me that I dealt with because of the person that I was, with just all the pressure that was on
you. Because you come from, you know, your accolades, if you guys don't know, this man is a legend in Long Beach, Long Beach Poly Alum.
Okay.
And so I remember looking, he used to be in the Vegas newspapers. That's how that's how nice dude was. So I can understand having that pressure and then going to SC and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, man, and being the first person in my family to go to college, and I got about 100,000 cousins. I'm Samoan and black. So when you got all that pressure and everybody's looking up to you to like be the one to make it,
right.
And then when you're not making it, you know, you're like, man, how did, but But nobody would be able to tell, because whenever you're around me or whenever you see me, you know, I'm always happy. I got a smile on my face, and I don't want to bring that negative attention or negative energy towards anybody else. So I just mask it, hone it down, right. And then by the whole time you're just killing yourself. So I think it was so big, man, when my boy Terrell Thomas, shout out to T Deuce, he told me to get a hold of you and to be a part of this. Can I be vulnerable?
Yeah.
Because that's exactly what I needed to do, was to be able to be vulnerable, to speak what was going on with me. You know, like, it's okay to, like, hey, I got, you know, I'm messing up. I got problems. So yeah, I need help from somebody instead of, you know, trying to help everybody.
Right.
Which, you know, everybody has a lot of people have a big heart.
Yeah.
I have a really big heart. So trying to, you know, actually asking for help was very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
Aaron?
I mean, for me, it was just bringing back those memories, those things I kept deep down. My mom looked at it, she was like, what's going on with you? She didn't know how I was feeling. She didn't even know I was feeling this way.
Right.
So having to bring that up, bring that to her, present it to her, not knowing how she would react, and letting her know in advance, this is who I'm meeting with, this is what I'm doing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It was tough.
Thomas.
Yeah, I would say the hardest part was, after I share this, how I would be perceived.
Right.
You know, once people see me, can I be vulnerable?
Right.
And if I'm authentically me, are you still going to accept me? Are you going to love me?
Right.
Or am I going to hold on to those same insecurities after I release it?
I mean, just to go off with exactly what you said, after I actually finally have the conversation, because I've been dying to speak about it, and it wasn't until I saw your first few clips, I was like, you know what? I just automatically got, yes, I have to do it, right?
Right.
So then once I was able to do that, especially as a host, you try to put on everything's good, blah, blah,
right,
blah,
right,
and smile, but deep down, like you said, we got some stuff that we're working out. So just being able to be in front of the camera and actually finally have the conversation was my key.
We're gonna switch gears a little bit. I got a question in from the boss lady. We're gonna talk about representation and or lack thereof of black men in the media, whether it be news, whether it be TV or just sports itself, because, you know, most of us on stage are athletes. We've played at a high level.
Right.
And so talk about what you saw, what you didn't see in media from black men growing up and now.
I think what we're lacking is the correct mentorship, you know, and like I said, I don't know if people watch, I'm sure people do, but they're like Last Chance U.
Right.
Just watching these kids talk about how football is all they got.
Right.
You know, it's so saddening. It saddens me, man,
right,
to see that, because
it's not.
Yeah, it's not. And then, but that's what the media wants to put out. You know, that's what they kind of want to show, for because it's a story for them. So, I mean, I think we're doing a better job of making mental health a little bit more mindful and aware of people. Now we got a month. I didn't even know it was mental.
Minority
mental
health.
Yeah, but I know it now.
And July, minority mental health awareness.
So I think we're making steps towards it, to making people aware and how important it is, because I mean, I didn't hear growing up, you know, just you got to be tough.
Man up.
You got to man up.
And that was always a thing.
Yeah, because the reason that they gave you that information is because that's all they knew.
Right.
You know, so finally, you know, having other people you know, the young adults, young black Americans could relate to, have the same type of stories and be able to share with them and let them know that they're, you know, in the same boat.
I mean, for me, just what I'd always see is just, you don't see a lot of it from the men as far as standing up and putting it out there as something to talk about, being okay to talk about. Even
right.
My stepdad, who played professional football, I watch him now, and he still struggles with it just because it's always what she was taught. Like Hershel said, when you play sports, we play football, you gotta be hard, you gotta be man up. And it just transitions into life as a father, as a leader, as whatever you are. And it's just, you see it more from the women pushing the men towards it than you do from the men. They're real hesitant.
And we like to resist it when they do it.
Yeah, I'm not doing that.
But they know, like, you can be better. And it's like, nah. Like, Thomas.
You know what? I think, you know, just watching you and as you put it out, it gave me the liberty to do it. And all of us up here and all the other alumni, I think that's the representation that we have the opportunity to give now. You know, I remember reading a quote said, vulnerability is not weakness, vulnerability is strength.
Yes.
And when you can see yourself and you can fully be who you are, it's just a liberating feeling. You don't hold things down.
Right.
And by having good friends who listen, or a therapist, somebody with an unbiased opinion to help us get our thoughts, mm-hmm. because being athletes, you were taught and coached to have specific thoughts, nothing else. You know, we had this saying, it was, you know, smart enough to line up, dumb enough to play.
Right.
And so for us, mm-hmm. we have to get to the point of, how are you feeling? Mm-hmm. How are you doing? And I would say that the person on the opposite side who's listening is really be invested in the answer. Don't just ask somebody how you doing and just keep on walking, right? How you doing? And you can see, and then you check in with somebody.
Right. Jimmy.
You know what? I think this type of conversation exactly here is what's needed to change the narrative that we haven't seen in the past years, you know? I'm a huge hip hop kid, you know? So, and listening to artists, you know, they never talk about mental health. They never talk about, you know, all these incidents that they go through coming up in their hood, or like, you know, different areas where they are actually experiencing, you know, PTSD from those certain situations, right. You know. So somebody like a J. Cole, you know, one reason why I love listening to his music is he actually speaks about mental illness, you know, mm-hmm. actually speaks about those topics that we are afraid to touch upon ourselves because somebody might look at us strange, mm-hmm. we might get joked on, yeah. but once we understand we're all human at the end of the day, and the conversation needs to happen in order for us to grow from it.
Right. So self-care tips. What do you personally do for self-care? Obviously, we've gone through some healing on our own terms, whether through therapy, mentorship, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So for your day-to-day, what do you do for, you know, to take care of yourself, your mental, your emotional?
I like to start with my morning. You know, I think the morning is really important. Waking up and feeding yourself some positive energy, some positive words of encouragement. Mm-hmm. I listen to Jim Rohn, John Maxwell, just some inspirational speakers to kind of get my mindset on the right track to start my day off. So.
Okay. Big on reading, writing. I've looked for different books. I ask friends, family, you know, what are you reading? What are you suggesting? And it doesn't have to be a particular type of genre, just
reading.
But for me, writing, just getting out thoughts, that frustration.
What you mean you don't listen to me in the book?
I forgot.
It's all right, man. Next time. Anyways, I sent you something. You know, first and foremost, man, I wake up and just be thankful. But even more important than that, I've started to journal, get my thoughts down on paper.
Right.
It's helped me. And then also, too, you know, physical fitness is big.
Yeah,
and it's not just how I look. It's how I feel.
Right.
And then other than that, man, just connecting with people, like really looking at somebody and being like, man, how y'all doing? I my soul needs that.
Right.
So that helps me.
Man, lately I've been meditating, you know. I take 10 minutes out of my day, at least minimum, just to sit down, gather my thoughts, wish myself luck on the day that's about to come, and I also pray, of course, you know.
Absolutely.
For me, I cannot be vulnerable, man. I'm not going to lie to you. That is my positive daily affirmation, to see grown men open up and get, you know, their emotions right, man. That's super dope for me. And also, the comments that I get the, you know, the phone calls and the text messages, the screenshots, the tweets of people saying, hey, I shared this with X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
Thank you for doing this. So those things right there, that's my, you know, my coping. That's my self-help, you know, my self-help thing. And it also keeps me going with this, because we're, 40-something episodes deep now, man. To get 40-something grown black men to say.
And then, can I take this time? Real quick.
And thank you everybody that watches and will continue to watch as well, man. We're gonna keep this going as long as men want to tell their stories, and young men and women and children and boss lady is talking to me. And also, we'll be back August 6, 2019 for part two of our CIBV collaboration with Mental State and KTLA. Be sure to subscribe to KTLA's YouTube page as well. And we'll have another group of alumni to talk right here about their mental health journeys and how they can be vulnerable as well. Thank you, fellas, man. I really do appreciate y'all.
Man, thank you, brother.
You, bro.